Preparing to delve in 3, 2, 1.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Delve. My name is Nathan.
And I'm Alex.
You know, I was thinking the other day, it's been a long time since we talked to Pat from Orcs Unlimited.
It has been.
Yeah.
I was totally thinking that the other day. Yeah. Funny how that works.
You know what is good, though?
Tell me.
Well, today on the show, Pat McNary from Orcs Unlimited is back with us. And Pat, welcome back to the show.
Yay! Hooray! It's good to be back.
Yeah, it's good to have you back. And of course, Orcs Unlimited, very famous for having some truly innovative and unique games. You know, the Teddy Bear Islands and the Kaijus and, you know, ink monstrosities that I do not want to encounter.
And the Emmy-nominated Space Pirates the Musical.
Yes, the Emmy-nominated Space Pirates the Musical, which is great if you like musicals and pirates and space, which, come on, who doesn't?
Right, it's all in one.
Yeah, it's all in one. Today, however, we want to talk about something that is coming right up. You have a Kickstarter starting soon for a game called Nine Card Dungeon.
Yes, it'll be our first card game.
Oh, really?
Yay, card game.
Yeah. Now, are there 9 cards?
There are 9 cards in play. I think there's a total of 14 cards available, and they kind of randomly mix in the dungeon to make the dungeon more random.
Okay. Well, then let me back up for a minute. Tell me what 9-card dungeon is.
So it's going to be a tile-based, like almost like a board game, and it, in the vein of the old school like race games. So you try to get through the dungeon faster than the other people, mm-hmm. and the dungeon is randomly created by the 9 cards you draw.
What inspired you to make the game?
We've been looking at, we have a couple card games in the works, and we're looking at something simple and fun to put out as our first attempt. One of our friends on Twitter had mentioned making a card game with 9 cards, and so I came up with this quick little idea. It kind of grew a little bit from the original concept, but it should be a nice, fun game to play with kids. It takes about 15 to 20 minutes to play through, so it's a quick card game that you don't have to know Monopoly or Catan that's going to cause people to throw tables.
Absolutely. Well, yeah, for anyone who's trying to teach your kids Monopoly, good luck. They're either going to become barons or they're going to hate you.
So no nuclear tetsujis will happen at the game table?
No card flips.
that seems like a selling point. That should be the tagline.
Yes, it's no not Monopoly.
Not Monopoly. That should be a board game. Not Monopoy. Yeah. It's a variant. it's a variant of Monopoly. Like, you know how they made like 500 different versions of Monopoly? Then there's Not Monopoly. And like, they just make it so that you go in reverse. You go around like Boardwalk and Park Place first.
Trying to become as poor as possible.
Yes. You start with like 1,000 fun bucks. And who can keep from going in debt first?
Debt.
They're in like a recession. You have all the hotels to start. You have to figure out how you can get rid of them.
Get rid of these hotels before they're repossessed by the bay.
Yes. Actually, this sounds like a really interesting game. It's Recessionopoly.
Recessionopoly.
Yeah.
I'm surprised that's not already a monopoly.
Maybe it is.
Might be.
Anyway, if anyone knows, let us know. So, 9-card dungeon. Tell me how I actually play the game.
So, everybody starts in the middle. There's a middle card, and then a card adjacent to the starting card, and all those are face down. So you have space movements, and you move. When you move to the edge of the card, you flip that card over, so the exit is placed randomly within those 9 cards. Mm-hmm. So you have to try to explore the dungeon and get around it. There's traps and monsters and things you have to get by, and the standard rolling of a d6 to try to get past them, and then depending on what which character you chose at the beginning of the game, you get bonuses to get past certain monsters. Mm-hmm. So it has some event, some old school role playing tent touches here and there as you move quickly through the dungeon.
How do I win?
There's a end space, a winning space, and pretty much the first person to put their meeple on the end space wins the game. Yay!
Yay! Excellent. Okay. Is this more of a like a competitive game or more a cooperative game?
It'll be a competitive game. We have a couple cooperative games in the work too. This one's meant to be a round the table race type competitive game, almost like a shoots and ladders or something old classic style with a little bit of a role playing touch.
Okay. Now tell me about some of these cards. What are some of these cards that are going to be in 9-card dungeon?
So all of your cards are basically the table, but you just shuffle the card. You take your start card and end card, shuffle the other 12 cards in, and then choose 9 cards so that the dungeon is never exactly the same every time you play.
Okay.
So it's always a random assortment, and it's not even the same 9 cards. There's a couple different cards, so makes it more random as you procedurally develop your dungeon.
Procedurally developed dungeon.
Right? I think I picked that up in some dev workshop somewhere.
basically, you've created like a roguelike, but for
almost
a game.
Roguelike table game, yes.
Yeah. That's neat. So are there any like monster cards in there?
There's monsters. So each card will have its own challenges, and some of the cards will have a monster on it or a trap or the chasm that you must climb over or something that harkens back to your classic D&D type days.
Are there any, what's my favorite monster? Are there any unicorns?
I thought you were going to say mimic.
Mimic.
Oh, are there any mimics? Yes. Mimics or unicorns or mimicorns?
A mimicorn? What's a mimicorn? Is that like the unicorn that eats mimics?
It's a unicorn that went to art school and it decided that it wanted to be a mimic. It's an interpretive sort of mimic.
I like it.
Yeah.
The monsters are all pretty much the same little kobold-looking monster, unfortunately. Might have to go back and make them all mimicorns now.
Yeah. Everything has to be a mimicorn. It's either a unicorn that really wants to be a mimic, or it's a mimic that just mimics unicorns. I can't tell which. Yeah, maybe it's just a mimic that's like, hey, we're all unicorns right now. Then you get really close to the unicorn because you're like, I want to pet the pretty unicorn. And it's like, its entire front part just opens up and it's a mimic.
Oh, eat your face.
Yeah. I was gonna say it just tries to eat you and take all your gear. Just throw rust monsters in. No one actually cares about them until they eat your gear.
Exactly. My favorite's still the gelatinous cube.
Well, of course. You don't see it until you walk into it and become part of it.
I like to put it they'll put like a cover on it on a bed, and then a character will lie down on the bed and fall into the cube.
It's a waterbed.
Yeah, like lie down. No, you're in a gelatinous cube.
There are no water beds in Dungeons and Dragons.
Exactly. Or at the bottom of a 10-foot pit. Like, oh, pit trap. Ha ha ha. Only you're in a gelatinous cube now.
Yep.
Actually, speaking of gelatinous cubes and pit traps, I had a designed and never used a dungeon where one floor was nothing but gelatinous cubes, but they're transparent unless you make a DC check to see them. I think in 5e it would be perception. But there were a ton of them, so you'd have to be making a bunch of checks and you'd walk into them if you didn't see it. And the next floor up from that were a ton of pit traps.
And then you would fall into the gelatinous cubes?
Yeah.
All right.
So you'd have to navigate through this maze of gelatinous cubes that were like held in place. And then you would go to the next floor and you'd have to not fall into these pit traps, which some would just drop you onto the floor below you and some would drop you into the cubes on the floor below you.
That's what I'm talking about. It's all about the gelatinous cube.
I may or may not be dastardly when I make traps in dungeons. So, you know.
Yeah.
No, you impossible.
Oh, Nathan's still pissed off about that one fireball.
I'm pissed off about a lot of things. No.
So nine card dungeon, huh?
Yeah.
Are there fireballs in Nine Card Dungeon?
No fireballs, unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on how you want to look at it.
No, it's fortunate.
Okay.
I'm happy that there are no fireballs. Are all the cards like a challenge that I have to get over?
Every card will have its own challenge. So it looks like a tile for like a board game. So it's got a number of different spaces to move through. And so there's sometimes one or two different challenges on each card. So there might be, and there's different directions you can go. Mm. So it's not a specific laid out pattern. So you're like, okay, I'm going to go to the left and fight the monster as opposed to go on the right to go over the pit trap because I'm a better fighter than I am a rogue. So I might get, it's easier for me to get past the monster.
Oh, okay. Okay. So all the cards are laid down at the beginning or as the game goes along?
So all the cards are laid down at the beginning, but everything except for the start card is face down.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to get to the edge of the start card to see the next card.
Oh.
So you don't know where the end's going to be until someone reveals that card.
Oh, okay. So each one of these cards has multiple spaces where I'm moving around on them.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Is there a chance that when you deal these nine cards down, that the end card won't be there?
Well, you would, at the beginning, you take the end card and shuffle it in. So you specifically put it in so that you're going to always have the end card.
Oh, okay.
Otherwise,
I was going to say, if there's like more than nine cards in the deck, then obviously you could have a chance of...
There's always the possibility there's no end card.
No, yeah.
Which is probably more entertaining for adult gamers as opposed to the 8-year-old gamers who would probably be disappointed they can't win the game. So.
Well, you know what you can do is that if it turns out there is no end card, you just like pop the other cards around it.
And yeah, then you start putting the rest of them around until you get to that end card. That's right.
Now it's just 14 cards.
Last one to run out of supplies wins.
Yay! Now it's survival dungeon.
Yes.
Kill each other.
Yeah, there should be you know what you could do is eventually you have an expansion and it's like a 16 card dungeon and you just have like a 4x4 grid.
And increase the grid size.
Yeah.
Add grids as you go. You add 18 cards at a time.
Yep. And you can have your start card like on the edge. Good luck, folks. Good luck. Enjoy. We've just turned a 15-minute game into a 3-hour game. Enjoy. Hope you like the marathon. You could just play a campaign, but with
9-card dungeon campaign.
Right.
Yay.
So
90-card dungeon campaign.
Oh my god.
Yeah, that might take a little long. It might be Monopoly at that point.
That's true.
Yeah. No, actually, if you're going to do 90, Alex, to get the full grid, just do 10 by 10 and do 100.
Card dungeon.
Yeah, that's going to be a large dungeon. That's a mega dungeon, but in card form.
See?
That's pretty great, though. You might have to play over multiple sessions. And then get maybe in those other cards, too, you can buy land. Like, I can buy plots inside the dungeon.
I'm going to buy this next one, so anybody who walks through this has to pay me.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, well, you know what you could have? You have, like, the trolls. And there could be tiles that have, like, bridges. And
you could have troll bridges.
Yeah, you hire the trolls that are under the bridge. And then
this is not my bridge, so you got to pay me to go through my bridge.
Yeah, exactly. See? Is that you start hiring some of the monsters in the dungeon to work for you.
Perfect expansion.
Yeah.
All right, then.
That's money and monsters.
Oh, I like it.
Yeah. Money monster. Oh, that was a movie. Sorry. Are all the characters, you're just using the little meeples?
Yeah, we're just using different meeples, and you have a different color. And so the red one, I believe, is the fighter, and the green one's a rogue. The white one's a priest. And I think there's a blue one who's a wizard. And so they each have like, basically you have to roll a certain amount to get past each thing.
Mm.
And each one gets a bonus when they go up against the thing they're better at. So the priest and that goes past the skeleton faster and the fighter gets past and so it gives you a little bit of tactics as you're trying to move through the board and see which direction you want to move. So you can figure out, like, well, if I want to actually get to the next card, I'm going to go past the monster because I'm a fighter. or I'll right. go past the trap because I'm the rogue. So.
So are you just naturally more adept at doing those things?
Yeah, you just it just gives you a bonus as like we try to keep it as simple as possible for because we want to do a family play.
Right.
So we didn't want to make a character sheets for each of the characters they go through. So if you're the blue one, you just get a bonus when you go when you cross the chasm, as opposed to trying to figure out which spells you might have or something to that extent.
Okay. Okay. So how do I determine if I've successfully done a thing?
You get the old fashioned D6 comes with it, and so your random number generator decides how fast you can get past said.
Beautiful. Okay. Okay. So, okay. And then I get a bonus to whatever I roll if I'm doing something that I'm good at.
Yeah. So if you're the fighter and you're fighting a monster, then you get a bonus. So it's an easier roll to make as you move past that monster.
Okay. Excellent. How many people can play?
It's a 2 to 4 players. Okay. You could play by yourself, but it'd be boring.
Fair enough.
Because I know who's going to win.
Not Nathan.
No, you know what's going to happen if I play by myself? My character's just going to die.
Like, oh, that wasn't even in the rules. How did that happen?
Yeah, well, now the new expansion is hardcore mode. Permadeath.
If you don't get past it, you die. So you better choose something you're good at.
And when we say permadeath, it's like literally if you die in the dungeon, the game wraps itself up and sets itself on fire, and you can never play again. You can never play again.
People jump down your throat, you choke.
Yes, you can never play that character again. Yeah, the fighter's dead.
Gonna have to send that game with a choking warning.
Uh-oh, yeah, I guess I can't have kids. No children under 3.
I think it's usually considered a choking hazard anyway, right? Because
I would think a meeple would be, and a die. It's a little 6-sided die, so you probably don't want little tiny kids play.
I was watching something one time. It's off topic, but I found this fascinating. Yeah, it's off topic. Who would have thought we would do that here? You know, like in pen caps, the ends of pen caps are kind of open. They do that so that it's not a choking hazard, so that you can still breathe if you accidentally swallow it.
And then you think, well, who would be stupid enough, and the next person you walk by is chewing on a pen cap? Oh.
Yep. That's the reason they did that, folks.
Should be a little star, the more you know.
You could be sitting there just like writing down like, you know, your hopes and your dreams, and then choking on the pen and going, wow, this is a near-death experience. Now I have to do all the things that I just wrote down.
That would suck.
That would suck. Yeah, all the things that I wrote down, and it wasn't your best work.
Yeah. I have to empty the garbage?
Yeah, I want to swim with turtles. No, I don't really want to swim with turtles. Well, I had a near-death experience. Got to do it now. It's in pen. It's not in pencil.
That's right.
It's permanent. I got to do it. No,
that's why erasers don't have holes, because if you chuck on that stuff, you're done.
Yeah, that's right. There is no erasers in the real world. You go for the eraser, it's all over. Going back to 9-card dungeon, did you enjoy the prospect of making like a smaller, like a micro game?
I was very, very excited. You know, all of our games are smaller than the average game. I like something that you can just pick up and play. So I really wanted something that I have a number of children. The kids are always like, can we play this? And it's like, well, they bring me a box of Catan. And I'm like, no, you got to go to bed in an hour. There's no way we can even start to. But if you got this, well, what can we play? Okay, well, we can play 9-card dungeon. It takes 15 minutes. You know, there's no real setup time. It's very quick. The kids get right into it. They've enjoyed playing it. The adults enjoyed playing it mostly because, you know, you can curse at each other while you're doing it. But it's really more of a family game. And we designed it to be really quick and easy to pick up. So that you don't have to explain. There's not 10 rules to explain to the children. There's two or three rules. So that the 5-year-old can play and keep up with his siblings. My children range from 14 to 3. And 3-year-old wants to play too. And a game like this, they have that. Except for they can't play with the pieces because they choke on them. But
right, except for that one thing, we're going to move the pieces for you.
Yes, but the rule is simple enough that they can decide which direction they want to move, and 14-year-old can still have a little bit of fun because it's always different. It's not always the same. They can play it on a slightly different level than the 3-year-old, but still, we can sit down and have a quick game with the family within a couple minutes. And that was, for my family, it was great. And I'm hoping that for other families, find it as enjoyable.
You know, they should have made a meeple that has a little hole in the center so that you can't choke
meeples
on it.
Meeples should have holes in the center. And yeah, they would be safe for children of all ages.
Yeah, yeah, they should. They should also be like, or you know what else you could do? Just have meeples that are just like gummies.
Oh, meeple gummies? We just chew that sucker. Meeple
gummies. You just, yeah, after you're done playing the game, have a little snack.
I think I have seen meeple candy, so that would probably...
Yeah.
That would probably work.
Somehow, right? That doesn't surprise me.
Yeah.
No, it's perfect.
Unless you want to play it.
Well, yeah, you know what that would be perfect for, though? Like Candyland?
Oh, see, I like it.
Yeah, candy. Yeah, yeah. That way, if you win the game, you get a treat.
You eat all of everybody else's meeples. You get suckers!
Yeah, you get to eat everybody else's meeples that they've been touching with their hands. It's just thinking, sanitary.
All of you people touch these. I'm going to eat them now.
Oh,
no.
Nobody picked their nose while we were playing.
Jeez.
Yeah, they were just all eaten by Mimikorn. No, no one saw it.
Mimikorns don't get diseases.
No. So, with the card mechanics, because that's like a new thing for you. Do you see yourself putting in card mechanics now that you're used to them in other games, like role-playing games?
I have a plan for a card-based role-playing game, but it's kind of, as people who follow my Twitter know, there's a backlog of games. And so it's kind of on the back burner. So I might look at some more card mechanics inside games.
Right.
And especially, we're looking at maybe an expansion for bugs that would use a card mechanic.
Ooh.
So our We Hunt Bugs might have we're thinking about doing an adventure through a junkyard of ships.
Mm.
And so the ships would always be different. And so you could just kind of play down room by room by room and have a mechanic there as opposed, and also a random... You pull a card to randomly generate what bugs are in that room, so that we would you could have a almost GM-less version of the game, so almost solo play or even solo play, so you could get through it.
Who needs a GM? Not us.
Well, some games are more talky than others. Bugs is more shooty than talky, so it'd work better for a game like that.
No, it's talky. You just talk with your gun.
Exactly.
I'll let the gun do the talking, damn it. It's fun. Now, with the Kickstarter, when does the Kickstarter actually begin?
Well, it'll probably start before you guys get this out. So we're going to start on October 31st.
Yep.
And then we're going to run for a month after that. So
sure.
That's about the standard Kickstarter run. I try to have a really low buy-in for the game. Thankfully, it's an inexpensive game to make and distribute. So we're starting at, I think, a $15 or $12 buy-in for it. So I see some Kickstarters where it's like, I wouldn't mind following that, but $65 for the initial, I'm like, yeah, I don't know if that's going to happen.
Yeah. It's a bit much of an investment for a game that you're going to be waiting multiple months, if not longer, for.
Many people in our community like to see the indies, you know, make some money and make the next project. But sometimes the buy-in's a little high, so I try to make this buy-in as low as possible. And I think it's $15 for the initial buy-in. It might be $12.
It's less than 20.
It's less than 20. It comes in a nice little card box with a couple meeples, the cards, the rules for the game. We had some, the game crafters is who we're going to be building this through.
Mm-hmm.
And we built some test samples that I didn't realize were pink, but we fixed that. we wanted to just put a basic piece of art on the box just so it would have something so you'd know it was what it was. And I didn't realize, I thought it was gray. And then when it came back from pink, I was like, oh, that's not gray. What? But if you're one of the half a dozen people or so that has the original pink box, you'll have a collector's item, right? So
there you go.
There you go.
I would say silver linings, but apparently it's a pink lining.
Pink lining. And then that got some good reviews, and we got a couple of great pieces of information back from that test play we did. And so we've implemented that. We've colorized the cards. Originally, they were just black and white. Added the extra cards to the dungeon to make it more replayable. And we have everything, all the artwork together. The cards are ready to print. So we're kind of doing this Kickstarter for us to try to get together enough to do a full 100 box print run so that we can take some with us to cons and things like that. So that's kind of why we did this, why would that. And Kickstarter really gets the word out better than many other venues. So we were kind of hoping to get some more word out to some people that this game exists, and and hope we get some reviews on it, some good word feedback on it before we have the next card game, which will be Trailer Park Wizards. right? Because we don't do anything normal.
At least not Trailer Park Alchemy.
No, that just explodes.
That's just Meth Labs.
That's right. We just call that Meth Labs.
It's Meth Lab.
Not that Meth Lab the game is a terribly bad idea, but that's for somebody else to do.
Meth Lab the Awakening.
It's Breaking Bad. That's all it basically is. It's Breaking Board Games.
Breaking Board Games.
Board Games. Yeah. Yeah.
It's just too mainstream for us to do over here at Orcs, so we'll let somebody else do Meth Lab.
Breaking Bards.
Breaking Bards.
That's perfect. Good. That's good, Alex. Just admit it. That is good.
That needs to be like one of those like live role-playing streams or something.
Oh, yeah.
Bards.
You have a team of bards, and they're somewhere in like the Forgotten Realms, but they're dealing with illegal substances, and they're trying to get like the guards off their back.
Perfect.
That's pretty great, and it will win so many Emmys. Right. Emmys. It will win some Emmys.
For best acting.
That's right.
It will be so good, though, the Emmys will even get involved and say, okay, live streams are acting. We're going to give you something for that.
I like it.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for the best live stream Emmy to be a thing.
Oh, yeah. Well, if it happens, hopefully by that time, the Adventures of the Hoof and Horn Detective Agency will be a thing. We will finally be able to put something into contention. Great. So the end goal for Nine Card Dungeon is that you'll be able to get these out to backers and also have another 100 print run that you can take to
conventions. To have a big print run that we can take to conventions. We're doing Gen Con's the one big con that we're gonna make this year. We had a couple other small ones we may or may not make.
Mm-hmm.
We've partnered up with some people who are going to be able to demo our games and bring our games. We have partnered with the Indie Game Alliance, who are great people.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to help us demo some of our games and some of the stuff that we can't make. The whole working real jobs thing makes it difficult to make a bunch of cons, so we had to kind of make a commitment to one or two, and we decided if you're going to do one, you might as well do the big one. So
might as well. That's generally good for a lot of things.
Our hope is to get to Gen Con with a couple of these games, show them to a bunch of people, and see, get these out to people's homes where they can enjoy them. Adopt a game. We're not going to sell games anymore. You're just adopting. It's, you know, it's like a, and those are just lonely games. You gotta
to rental.
Give them their forever home.
Yeah, just, exactly.
This game needs its forever home.
Yeah, it really does change the meaning of like games library. It's like, yeah, you have to check the game out, and you have to check the game back in. That's how this works. I felt like the term games library was a little misleading. Like you don't actually own any of those. Or just makes libraries seem really sad. Because, like, the libraries are like, no, it's not like that. You have to give these back at some
point. Bring them back. But no, I love this book. It needs to stay with me.
Who gives the books back? Really? Who does that? Silly. So, what is your goal for Nine Card Dungeon?
Our goal, I believe, is $800. So it's a very reasonable low end goal. We didn't have to pay for art; it was already done. When we did ink. Ink is a game that's coming out here shortly, and it costs over the course of 3 years because I slowly purchased the art from amazing artists throughout the world. I've spent $4,000 on the artwork so far for this game. So we're not even going to attempt to recover that in a Kickstarter. It's just not going to happen.
Right.
When we finally hopefully do the Kickstarter for that game, it'll be to get a print run so we can take to Gen Con and other conventions. It won't really be to cover the production costs.
Right.
One day I hope to be wildly successful and I can do something to cover production costs of a game, but that's probably not in the immediate future.
Who doesn't want to be very successful?
Sometimes people just do things. They're like, you know what? I'm going to be the shittiest game developer ever. Watch this.
Someone's like, I'm going to make games that are so bad they're good.
Exactly. Hold my beer.
I'm going to do the B movie equivalent of gaming design. All right. Oh man, let's see if we can make Birdemic but in game form.
Yes,
it's trauma.
I hope you enjoy it as much as you enjoyed that sci-fi special this week.
you enjoy Manos, the Hands of Fate in card form now.
Card form, yay!
Joy. And it's kind of like Nine Card Dungeon, but since there's no editing, it's actually the 90 card dungeon.
90 card dungeon.
And
you just get there when you get there.
Yeah, most of those cards are blank. They have nothing on them. Yeah, exactly. You just have to figure out what you want to put on them. It's not just choose your own adventure. It's literally make your own damn adventure. We're not even going to bother.
And it's a $90 buy-in on Kickstarter. So
absolutely. Yeah, $1 for each card.
$1 for each card. Cards are expensive.
Yep, certainly are. What, you want cards that don't automatically degrade in your hands?
I mean, that'd be nice.
You want the moon, don't you, Alex? You just want everything.
Some days.
So that's Nine Card Dungeon. Anything else I need to know about Nine Card Dungeon in terms of like mechanics or things?
It was meant to be a really simple game, so there's not a lot of mechanics to it. I guess that's almost the selling point, is that there's not a lot of mechanics. It's simple for everybody to learn. It's easy to pick up and put back down and play a game or two with the kids or before your weekly D&D game starts and you're waiting for everybody. It's not really meant to be the next big board game. It's just meant to be the fun distraction in between the next big board games.
That sounds fun. And you know, if you have like adults around and you just have the adults and you want to play a game like Nine Card Dungeon, you could like make it a guessing game. Just put the cards on your forehead.
Oh yeah.
And you could have fun.
You're the exit.
You could have you could just keep giving people clues as to what's on your card. That's always fun. You can make your own fun.
Make your own fun. It's all about making your own fun.
Absolutely.
That's just generally good advice. You know, when in doubt, make your own fun. We were happy to have Patrick back on the show because it feels like, you know, we kind of have to have an update on everything Orcs Unlimited at least once a year, considering there are like 100 different things that they're doing over there. And we're very happy that they have the Kickstarter out now for Nine Card Dungeon. You can find it over on Kickstarter there at this moment. But of course, we had so many other things that we needed to discuss with Patrick. And so on the next show, we are going to get some updates on the other games that Orcs Unlimited produces, for instance, Ink. and some other materials for Escape from Teddy Bear Island and We Hunt Bugs that they're working on. We find out a little bit more about Space Pirates the Musical. There's so many things. There's more than that. If you want to find out more about Orcs Unlimited, you can go over to orcsunlimited.com and you can see a plethora of things. You can also find more about Delve over at delvecast.com and make sure to click on that Patreon banner if you would like, because we always have some fun exclusive stuff for you over there, including unabridged, unedited versions of the show, the complete interviews in one big, long package with all these ahs and ums that you hope for. It's all there. If you become a patron, even at the $1 level, you get all the supplemental material. But we would like to send a special shout out, of course, to our shiny level patrons, Bonnie Ainsworth and Dominic Perry. So much fun. Find Delve on iTunes, Google Play, every podcast app imaginable. I think that we just end up on there automatically when one launches. I'm pretty sure that's how it works. And make sure to check us out on Twitter. I am at Citanium. Alex is at EXP Limited, and the show is at Delve Podcast. And of course, you can also find Orcs Unlimited at Orcs Unlimited. We will, of course, be back to talk more about teddy bears and bugs and ink monsters and such on the next show. Until then, thank you for joining us, and good gaming, folks.
Now you've got a case of all the right. Mondays like a lasagna cat.
Let's just not talk more about lasagna.
Did you look it up? Did you check it out?
Nope.
Does Pat know it? He said, nope. Ooh.
I was assuming it was a reference to Garfield.
Kind of. Sort of, but not. Oh, I should ask Jake if he checked out lasagna cat.
Alex has this weird thing about lasagna cat.
No, I don't.
It is not Garfield. It looks like it would be Garfield, but it is not Garfield. And I don't know. It was while they were talking about creepypasta, I can only imagine it's something along that line.